is our ability to be attuned to other human beings. And it's from this attunement that we develop compassion and empathy. It's our ability to allow our inner state to shift so that we can resonate with what's going on inside of another person. Emotional balance comes out of executive function. So this is our ability to, as he would say, navigate the waters between rigidity on one bank and chaos on the other. So we keep things in balance. So we don't become so over logical and overthinking things that we become very rigid, but we don't become so emotional that things just become chaos. We manage to hold the two in balance. Response flexibility is the ability to put a pause between your response and your action. So when you have a response to something, rather than just react to it, you're able to stop for a minute and think about it before you act. So that's a really important skill that part of brain development that children have to learn, to think, to stop and think before they act. Sometimes adults need to learn that as well. Fear modulation, we already kind of talked about the ability of this part of the brain to help calm fear. So literally, fibers from this upstairs brain, Siegel explains, there's like inhibitors that actually fall down upon the part of the brain that creates fear and literally calms it down. It gives it like a little chemical sort of soother to just take the edge off and calm us down. And so he notes that we can actually teach our brains to do this. We're not just subject to the winds of nature on this. We can actually train our brains through neuroplasticity, which we're going to talk about. But we can train our brains so that we can stop using that impulse control, where we can stop and think. We can stop and think, we can pause, and we can look at the context of a situation and kind of tell our brains to calm down. The next one is empathy, and empathy is sort of a notch up from attunement. It's related to attunement, but it moves us from just a resonance and a feeling with other people to an ability to actually see from another person's point of view. And Siegel talks about this as creating a U map. Insight, the next one, is insight into our own selves. It's our ability to be self-reflective, and it's the ability to create what he calls a me map, to understand myself. And then empathy is my ability to create a you map, my ability to understand you, to see from your perspective. And then moral awareness is my ability to create what he calls a we map. It's my ability to understand and think about and enact my behaviors for the purpose of the social good, rather than just my own good, or even just the good of a loved one. And then the final one is intuition, which is access to this wisdom that we get from our entire bodies, our viscera, our heart knowledge, our gut knowledge, etc. The other important piece here to note that was mentioned in the video about how our brains are built is that when the brains of children are flooded with stress and stress-generated neurotoxins, these neurotoxins actually diminish the neurons and disintegrate the nerve fibers that are used to make all of these connections. Without these connections, executive function becomes impossible. So this is, I could give a whole nother talk on childhood trauma and what childhood trauma does to the brain. But it's something that I really want to invite us to think about, and to think about when we look at adults in our society. This is where that Beauty and the Beast and Prison Reform article on Scientific American's website came in. But it's important because we have to recognize what happens when children suffer trauma, what happens when they become adults and they don't have this ability of executive function because their brains didn't develop it. And their brains didn't develop it because of the trauma they suffered in childhood. So I'm not saying that's the case for every person in prison, but actually I quoted a statistic in that article, and I may be misquoting it, but I believe it was like 70% I'm going to kind of rush through these pieces just to give you these other pieces of the puzzle so that we can kind of move to the God talk and the spirituality piece. Siegel defines mind. I gave you a definition on your handout there, but basically, mind is distinct from brain. Mind is an emergent property. It's embodied and it's relational, and it regulates what he calls the flow of energy and information within the brain, within my own brain, but also between brains. So mind is what he calls an emergent property developed from our brains, but also from our interactions with one another. My brain cannot develop in any way, and my mind cannot form if I am by myself. It can only happen when I'm in relationship with other human persons. So relationships are key to shaping both the mind and our embodied brain. And that's that kind of triangle you see there on the page. Which I want us to think about. about in terms of how they impact our spirituality and our relationship with God. So integration, remember, Siegel actually has several different forms of integration. The ones we've talked about primarily tonight, I briefly mentioned bilateral, that left brain, right brain integration. And then the vertical, the reptilian brain with our limbic regions, with our cortex regions. So he says, you know, the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. And so creating this, and then the integration again between our brains and other person's brains, and the integration with our minds as well. So the whole of all of these things is greater than the sum of the parts. And what creates integration is having differentiation. So for example, within our brains, having different parts of our brains that have specialized functions that do certain things, and then having linkage between those parts which are differentiated. Likewise, I would say with human beings, differentiation, I am not you, you are not me, and yet the linkage, the interconnection, interrelationship between us is what creates wholeness. And he says brains that are integrated are going to show these attributes. They're going to be flexible, adaptive, coherent, and stable. So looking at coherence, and Siegel, as you can tell, likes attributes, he breaks it down into these attributes. A person who has coherence is connected. And again, as I read these off, they're on your sheet, but as I read these off, think about them in terms of how they might impact our spiritual lives. We're connected, open, harmonious, engaged, receptive, emergent, noetic, compassionate, and empathic. So executive function is what is key to creating integration in the brain. And relationships, human relationships, interrelationship is what is key to creating executive function. Being loved makes us feel safe and seen. And when we feel safe, we are open and receptive to others. And when we feel seen, we experience being real, being connected, being felt by another person. When we do not experience being loved, we tend to feel unsafe, and we're closed off, isolated, guarded, and alone. So what I want to suggest here is that our relationship to God is key in this whole process. And our relationship to others is grounded in our relationship to God, who is love. Our relationship to God, who is love, is mediated in and through our intersubjectivity, in and through our relationships with one another. So, Daniel Hughes is another researcher in this field or a related field, and he uses another acronym. Apparently they like acronyms, so you can remember, I guess. He actually uses the acronym PACE. Others have used PLACE. And PLACE stands for playful, loving, acceptance, curiosity, and empathy. And I would like to suggest that we can ground both our relationship with God and our relationship with others in this acronym. So playfulness indicates fun and laughter, reciprocal enjoyment, confidence, and hope. The researcher Jaap Panksepp, who's also known as the rat tickler, because he did experiments tickling rats, and there's actually videos of him doing it, discovered that play is the source of joy in our brains. He also discovered that play increases gene expression in our frontal lobes and thus contributes to the growth of executive function. Play strengthens our immune system and increases our resilience. It also increases serotonin, the happiness hormone, which in turn increases neural connectivity. So in other words, play and the resulting joy from play make us healthier, stronger, happier, and smarter. So how often do you play? And by play, I actually don't mean playing Candy Crush on your cell phone or on your tablet. I mean, when you look at your interactions with other human beings in your life, how often do you play? How often are you fun and playful? How often do you tickle or wrestle or act like a kid again? Brain studies show that these elements are essential for children whose brains are in the midst of their development, but given our own neuroplasticity, we can all use a bit of more play and a bit more joy in our lives. This doesn't mean that you have to have a pillow fight with your spouse when you go home, though, you know, if you want to, good for you. But it might mean finding ways to interact with children more. It might mean becoming childlike in order to discover the reign of God. It might mean having a dog to play with, or perhaps you have a cat and you can get your cat to humor you and let you play with your cat for a while. So part of my question to you is, how can you incorporate play into your spiritual life? The next one, loving, is pretty self-evident, I think, and the reason why Hughes doesn't include it, others have added it to his system. He says, I didn't include loving because loving is fundamental and should undergird our whole way of being. All of these attributes should include loving. Loving is just fundamental to doing what we are as human beings. Acceptance means accepting another's internal experience. It does not mean that you necessarily accept the behavior of another. It does not necessarily mean that you agree with another person. But it means that you accept their experience as being their experience. It means that you, when you are accepted, it means you feel that your experience is being accepted and acknowledged as being your experience. And so there's a mutual acceptance of one another's thoughts and desires, wishes, feelings, beliefs. Again, it doesn't mean that you agree with the other person, but you accept that this is part of their experience, part of their reality. And I would suggest it's the way that God accepts us, that God accepts us as who we are in all of our experiences and how that creates us and who that creates us to be. Connected to that acceptance, then, is curiosity, because you have to be curious about another person if you're going to discover their thoughts, desires, wishes, and beliefs. Curiosity is your interest in another person as other. In other words, not trying to make them the same as you, but being really genuinely curious to find out who they are and what makes them sort of tick inside. And for me, again, I imagine God's curiosity for us. In prayer, we bring all that we are to God, who's ever curious, who's ever interested in always knowing us more deeply, and at the same time, knows us more deeply than we could possibly ever know ourselves. So in other words, when we bring ourselves before God and before God's curiosity, we aren't really in that process of prayer revealing ourselves to God so much as in and through that prayer we are revealing ourselves to ourselves. When we open ourselves up to God, we end up opening ourselves up to ourselves and learning more about who we are as persons. And when we can place in us the mind of God, then we can approach other people with that same curiosity, with that same acceptance, with that same love, with that same playfulness that God approaches us with. And empathy is the way that we communicate all of this to another person, the way in which we make another person feel seen and feel safe in our relationships. And so I would suggest that we can take all of these points into our own prayer, use our imaginations, use guided meditations, allow ourselves to feel seen and to feel safe in the God who is love. And then we take that attitude and we bring it into our actions in the world and with those around us. We're going to skip this part on meditation. I know you guys have done other programs on meditation here, and I think it's repeating a lot of the same thing. I will say, it is interesting, and I put the videos on your sheet as well. If you get a chance to go and look at this video on the power of meditation, there's been so many studies now about what happens to the brain when we meditate and how much healthier we are as persons when we meditate. So two things I would say. Know that if you go and listen to the video, that they talk about the fact that meditation increases our heart rate variability, which should sort of spark a memory of the very beginning of this presentation, where I talked about heart rate variability leading to greater social skills and a greater regulation of our emotions and a greater ability to cope with stress in social situations. So that is increased in us through the practice of meditation. Also, while we all know that the benefits in the brain are much greater for, say, Tibetan monks who spend, you know, much of all day, every day meditating, research has also shown that meditation can change the brain in as little as 5 weeks. So you don't have to have been a lifelong Buddhist monk meditator in order for your brain to be impacted by meditation. Just 5 weeks of meditation can make changes in the brain. So I always remember a quote from a centering prayer lesson that I once heard where the presenter said, "It's not that I don't yell at my kids anymore, I just yell at them less loudly." So that's what I strive for. How are we doing time-wise? Okay, I did say I would stop at 7:30 so we could have some conversation. I'm going to say that was a little bit of a lie because I want to touch on one more thing before we move to our conversation. We talked about love guesting up here already. I just want to give you this image of God. And this is, if you're interested at all in this, not that I'm trying to sell my book, but it is what my book on the Trinity is about, which is this image of God. You know, classical theology is image of God as being, which is all good and well. I think we need a lot of analogies and metaphors as ways to think about God, who is always first and foremost mystery. So I'm going to give that little caveat. But the metaphor, the image, or the analogy that I like is this image of God as love. So if I'm coming from a Christian perspective, so my image of God is Trinity. So looking at the first person of the Trinity, looking at the source of love, which is then revealed in the Word of love, which becomes incarnate. So think about love incarnate in the person of Jesus Christ. And that source of love which is enacted in the Spirit of love in the world. And so we learn what it means to be, in the Christian tradition, we learn what it means to be a human person by looking at the person of Jesus Christ, who is the incarnation of love. And we learn what it means to be community in and through the Spirit creating the interrelationships between us that make us into community, as the Christian terms we would say, that make us, that knit us into the body of Christ, so that we are then the incarnation of love in the world, God's love in the world. So that's just a quick overcap on that. And then the final points, which I could say a lot more on, but I'll just, you know, I think it's somewhat self-explanatory that the fundamental experiences of these are through our own experience of our own consciousness and our self-actualization, grounded in God who is love, but always mediated through love of neighbor. So that interrelationship between love of God and love of neighbor, that we can't come to know ourselves without coming to know the God who created us and coming to know the neighbor through whom we together become fully flourishing human beings. So I'll leave you with a quote for Bronner, and then I'm going to offer you some challenges for our discussion. The quote from Rahner is that human beings necessarily commit themselves, entrust themselves to others, and that indeed they must do so. This self-opening of one's own personhood to another, this handing over of oneself to someone else, admits of the greatest variation in intensity and in form. Only if one thus abandons oneself and lovingly sinks into the other, does one succeed in finding oneself. Otherwise, a person languishes in the prison of his or her own selfishness. So that interrelationship, again, being at the core of what it means to be a human person. And so the challenges I want to leave you with are, what happens when we live in a society where there are so many people whose lives have not been filled with loving relationships, whose lives have been filled with abuse? out of our reptilian brains, perceiving the other as a threat and allowing fear to inhibit our compassion and our willingness to help? Or do we respond with love and nurture, with receptivity and healing, and trust the God of all love to cast out our fear? So with that, I'm going to turn it over to you. I don't know if you want to have some discussion in among yourselves for a few minutes, and then we'll bring it back to the large groups. Or do you want to invite into a large group discussion?
So do you have questions right now?
If you wait for the mic so we can hear.
You said the brain changes in 5 weeks of meditation. Is that deep
meditation?
You said the brain changes in 5 weeks of meditation. Is that daily meditation?
Yes. So that's in the experiment they set people up to do. I believe it was one 20-minute session or two 20-minute sessions a day, but they did 20-minute sessions a day every day for 5 weeks, and then did MRIs before and after. And I will say, just as a caveat on that, I have two little kids. I don't meditate 20 minutes a day. I have a 2-year-old and a 4-year-old. I don't meditate 20 minutes a day.
Thanks, Dr. Russell. As a therapist for many years, I have come in very close contact with people, even with reactive attachment disorder, which is probably trauma on steroids early on. And there's little consciousness really that we know about. So to have such a clear example of how we don't develop when tenderness is not present is striking. Thank you for making that point.
It's huge. My son is adopted and my daughter is with me through foster care, and both of them came into my home at the age of 2 days old. So there's a whole thing about the experience of separation from their own parents, trauma in their lives, and things that they suffered in utero. But they have grown up in my home. Many of my friends who are foster parents have taken in children of much older ages, many of whom have reactive attachment disorder, precisely for this reason, because when people experience extreme abuse, and they're actually finding now that abuse in some ways isn't even as bad as neglect. And neglect is way more common than abuse because the neglect, these parts of the brain just simply don't develop.
Thanks for that. I hope that people can.
Yes. So thank you for bringing up the element of hope back into that. That with love and attachment and relationships, healing is possible.
So I have a question for you. So your image of God is one of love.
Yes.
But that's not everyone's image of God. Can you say a little bit about that?
Sure. So, you can go from, a lot of people have a very anthropomorphic image of God. So, they image God as a person. That kind of stereotypical Sistine Chapel open in the sky image. Many people were brought up with an image of God who is judge and very much don't experience God as love, but experience God as judging their actions. I was raised as a child of the 70s, so I would say, I'm Catholic, and so we were what they call collage Catholics. We didn't get a whole lot of doctrine, but we got to make collages every week about the fact that God is love. So I would say, if you're only going to teach kids one thing, to teach them that God is love is a pretty I would challenge that. I don't want to say this because, again, I don't want to be judgmental about where other people are coming from or what other people's images of God is, but I think that it's troubling to me, theologically, when people experience God in a way where God is a source of stress and anxiety and fear instead of a source of love and grounding all that is healthy and
whole in us, if that makes any sense. Other questions? Thank you very much. I have a who am I? Yes. Not me personally. If you could property. He also talked about the spiritual practice of the spirit. Could you explain to me how you understand the spirit?
Yes, well, that's a hard question. So I am a Ronarian scholar in my very being. Karl Rahner has a very different understanding of spirit than most people do. And I would say, for me, we are embodied spirits or spirited bodies. So my understanding of spirit is not dualistic in any way. I don't understand this, my spirit as being something separate from me or distinct from me or anything other than simply me. I am my spirit. I am inspirited. I am embodied. I am embodied spirit and inspirited body. So the way Rahner talks about spirit is he defines it as human transcendence. The experience of I'm always moving beyond any finite thing. So, you know, it's that dynamism of the human person where nothing ever satisfies us. It's my openness. Spirit is my openness to that which is infinite. Embodiment is my finite, the finite part of my being. Spirit is my openness to the infinite, if that makes any sense. And so, mind and spirit, they get real dicey when you start to try to dissect out what's the difference between mind and spirit. For me, I guess I would say in some ways mind is another way of talking about spirit. Though certainly there are definitely philosophers and theologians that make very clear distinctions between mind and spirit. For me, both are ways of talking about who I am at the core of my being. If that makes sense.
Other questions?
I have one to fill in the gap.
So we talked about, and gave a quote from the Bible which talked about love and fear.
Can you give us a quote about gratefulness with God?
There is one, and I was going to look it up, but I forgot. It's from the wisdom literature where it talks about, friends, wisdom makes us friends and prophets of God. There's like a quote about wisdom and the playfulness and dancing across the waters, but I am Catholic, so I don't quote scripture. I say, somewhere in the Bible it says something about. And that's not as good as I can get, but there are lines, and if you do a Google search, I'm sure you can find them about the playfulness of God. There was actually another line I have to say, and I used this in the section on chaos in my book Quantum Shift, but there's a line where they're talking about Leviathan, and I found this so interesting when I was reading the commentaries on the Hebrew scriptures, where the context is really, so in the ancient Near East, they had these monsters, these creatures of chaos, like Leviathan. And then when the Hebrew scripture was written, it wrote about it as if Leviathan was like God's pet, and God played with Leviathan. So Leviathan being the image of chaos, and this is a whole other piece about the connection between chaos and complexity, and how creation comes out of chaos. But yeah, so that image of God playing in chaos.
Your reference to 1 John, perfect love and now fear. This is actually, I think, the cross for many of us is perfection in this form is actually not attainable. Perfect love, you know where that happens. Can you address how we don't have to be perfect out of fear?
Absolutely. So I, you know, the perfect love, I would say, the author of that passage in scripture is talking about God's love. It's God's love that casts out fear. You know, so where I would say, you know, we put in us the mind of God, and I'm going to talk in very Christian terms now because, again, that's my background. But for me, it does come down to what we would call Christology in the sense of, so I talked a little bit, and this is all coming from Karl Rahner, by the way. I talked about us being openness, a spirit, we're openness, we're transcendence. We, in our openness to God, openness to the infinite, openness to this perfect love, tend to fill it with all sorts of things that are finite. We you know, it's the Augustine quote about our heart is restless until it rests in thee, O God. That quote actually begins with, you created us for yourself, O Lord, and our heart is restless until it rests in thee, O Lord. And that restlessness or that tendency to fill our openness with everything that is not God and is not love and is not goodness. That's our humanness. Our response to God, our response to love, is always a mixture of yes and no. We're never perfectly open to love. As much as we risk, we also hold back. It's in our human nature as well. But in the person of Christ, who I would say is this incarnate word of love, who is this incarnation of God's love, we have this perfect yes to God. We have this image, we have this, and what we do is through that spirit, through that grace in our lives, we can unite our partial and our finite yeses to that infinite yes, to that perfect yes to God, to love. So I would say, you're right, we are a mixture of yes and